So speak life. Hi, and welcome to Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker. Glad you stepped on the bus today. This is a show, we do this every single week, about struggle, about worry, about faith, about dealing with life. We have guests on here who have found themselves in a difficult place, and through the help of and the hand of God, found victory. And a deepened faith through that process. And if that's where you are today, realize no matter how hopeless a situation appears, there's always hope. God will always take any situation and turn it into a blessing, given the time and embracing His power over the situation. He can guide you through it, and He can also give you the strength to handle it. And we also feature people who have found the call to help others. And that's what today is about. John Crooks with the Emerald Youth Foundation is here with me. Hi, John.
Hey, Tom. Great to be with you.
Nice to have you. And I've heard of the Emerald Youth Foundation for a long time, but I know little about it. Therefore, I called you.
You call the right guy, hopefully.
Yeah. You are the Marketing Communications Director at Emerald Youth Foundation. You've been there how long?
10 and a half years, yeah.
Okay, so you've learned a little about their process.
Yeah, just a little bit.
A bit. Tell us, I mean, because you help a lot of people, and especially the sweet spot, the youth, when kids can either turn away or turn toward God. And you're helping the urban.
Correct, yes.
So tell us, just give us a 30,000-foot view of what Emerald Youth Foundation is.
Sure. So Emerald Youth Foundation is an inner-city youth ministry here in Knoxville that is more than just a single program. We go pretty deeply with kids across the city. We started more than two decades ago. As a matter of fact, we've just kind of wrapped up our 25th anniversary celebration.
Goodness, that's hard to imagine.
Yeah, it is. We were officially founded in 1991. Just wrapping up our 25th anniversary, but prior to that, started out as the youth ministry, real organic, just kind of youth ministry out of Emerald Avenue United Methodist Church. Which is
hence the name
Emerald, right? Okay. Off of Emerald Avenue.
Gotcha.
Just started out there, literally just kind of threw out a basketball in the back parking lot. And the church itself had been through some struggles, talking about struggles and faith. The church itself had really had some challenges in the mid to late 1980s, and found itself in a position where the pastor at the time said, Bob Bean, who's just a wonderful gentleman, and the congregation said, how do we fix this, right? How do we, be engaged in the community more? And they knew that that really needed to start with kids, with the young people.
Absolutely.
And so they really made a concerted effort to reach out to kids, really just right in the Oakwood-Lincoln Park neighborhood where the church is located.
Right.
And they hired a part-time youth intern. His name was Steve Diggs. He had just graduated from Maryville College. Well, today Steve is our president and CEO.
So he's stuck
around.
He's
been with us.
Yeah.
So Steve has been with us from the very beginning. And Steve, along with the church, just launched this effort to reach and serve kids in that neighborhood. And we've had the blessing and the ability to grow over all these years. And so now we work with a number of churches throughout the city.
Okay. So the goal is kids, but you have different type programs that benefit and hopefully catch them where they can have a different idea. Instead of going to the houses or meeting places of gangs, you offer them a different option.
Yeah, so we serve more than 2,000, probably this year it'll be close to 2,200 or 2,300 young people across the city of Knoxville. So And when I say city of Knoxville, so I grew up here, but we think really about our urban neighborhoods. So places mm-hmm. like Mechanicsville, Lonsdale, Burlington Five Points, Oakwood Lincoln Park, really focused on the center of the city. And again, more than 2,000 kids each year. And that's in age range from about early elementary school, first, second grade, all the way through young adults. So we don't want to
goodness. So it's a wide range.
Yeah, we don't want to just kind of wrap up with them when they turn 18 and graduate high school, hopefully. We really want to try to walk with them through those early young adult years to help make sure that they stay on a solid path moving forward.
Okay.
So what we do is we focus on faith, learning, and health. And relationships are really built into all of those areas.
Absolutely.
So we look at the outcomes that we can have with young people in helping them grow in their faith, helping to ensure that they have a strong education, that they do well in school and pursue college or other workforce training. And then from a health standpoint, a number of health, recreation, and sports opportunities that we offer young people because a high percentage of young people in our city's neighborhoods are not involved in what you would consider really organized sports.
Is it because of availability or is it just interest or not believing in themselves?
I think it's hard to say. I think it's probably a mixture of a lot of things, probably all of those things.
Okay.
And so from an availability standpoint, we're trying to increase those opportunities.
Sure.
And provide more options. A perfect example would be girls volleyball. So when I started 10 almost 11 years ago, we may have had the sport. If it was, it was really in its infancy.
Yeah.
But it has exploded, and so now we have a recreational girls volleyball league in the fall. With this fall, I would say we'll probably have close to 150 middle and high school girls in this league.
Wow.
That's a league that we would run. But then we're also had the opportunity here in the last few years through our partnership with FCA. We were talking about that before the show started.
Yeah.
So our partnership with Fellowship of Christian Athletes has allowed us to work closely with schools like Northwest Middle School, Whittle Springs Middle School, to where we can sponsor teams. So we have girls volleyball teams
at the school.
Okay. So they have that pride and that the Whittles team or Northwest team, they have a school team, but we're able to actually sponsor it and provide the funding and the resources for it.
And the resources, absolutely.
Yeah. And they're competing against other girls teams in Knox County.
Goodness. Okay.
So that's just one example of where something, it started out real small, kind of a niche there, but it's grown.
But you found a sweet spot that there's a lot of interest, but there wasn't a lot of availability.
Right, right.
And so do you offer ways for kids to get to this, if it's not very close to where they live, how does that work?
Yeah, so that's a great question. With all of our programs, we try to be very neighborhood focused so that hopefully, for the most part, transportation is not too much of an issue. Through our network of churches that we work with in the city, many of those churches do have some sort of transportation, buses, whatever. Emerald Youth, we also have, a fleet of vehicles that we utilize as well. But in our after-school program, our discipleship program in the afternoons, we're picking kids up from school, either on those church buses or our buses, and taking them to the churches where we're mentoring, discipling those children. And then, for example, with our sports, if the teams are traveling or whatever, we're, providing that.
Yeah. So on the surface, kids... And I remember very well early on when you didn't have something to do, not the best things happen sometimes.
Right.
And so you're giving them not only something to do, but you're giving them a purpose.
Yeah, that's a great point. It's in many ways, it's more than just about, excelling in one of the sports that we offer or doing well in school. I mean, all those things are good, but at the end of the day, we want to help each of the young people we serve grow in a relationship with Christ, so that from a faith standpoint, that their heart is in the right place, and that they're pursuing that throughout their life, throughout their lives, that there is a greater purpose from a faith standpoint, but then also from a serving the community and thinking bigger than just, you know, their neighborhood or the streets that, you know, they're in, you know, that's a great place to start. But, you know, big picture, we've got some, young people who have done some neat things, are doing amazing things. And,
Oh, I want to get into stories.
Right.
But first I want to talk about your relationship with churches. How did that develop? And how does that work? Because that's got to be an integral part. And I know kids don't just automatically migrate to churches when they get out of school. Yeah. So you've made it inviting.
I think we have. So I mentioned at the beginning, you know, we started out of Emerald Avenue UMC. So that was really the first church. And then kind of grew from there. And it was just very natural growth, because there were so many churches in the city, you know, within the city limits, but not many of them had or have the resources to offer youth ministry and programs with kids. So instead of saying, all right, we want to raise a bunch of money and build a bunch of youth centers or what have you, let's look at the existing infrastructure with churches and use those buildings and facilities and work with the congregation so that they really have the buy-in.
But they may not have a youth leader or the resources to have a program like that.
Exactly. And, you know, not that there is anything wrong with building facilities and serving children that way. We have done that in some ways.
Sure,
but
that's a lot of money.
It is, yeah. And from the faith standpoint, it makes sense for us to work with churches, right? We have a number of churches in the city where Emerald Youth Foundation staff are working out of the churches, and our after-school programs are run out of those. And so we'll have, for example, a children and youth director at one of the churches who's facilitating and implementing the programs there, making it, you used, I think, the word inviting, you know, so that the kids can get excited about it and come in. And so my colleagues who are out there, you know, in the neighborhoods each day, they're knocking on doors and building relationships with parents and families.
You're getting buy-in
and the kids.
From the family.
Yeah,
that's big.
And that is key, because it's not just the young person getting dropped off or picked up, you know, and taken to the church, but it's how can we build that relationship with their mom and dad or their grandparents or their guardian, and hopefully extend that impact, not just with the young person, but you know, to a bigger picture.
So you probably can't pinpoint exactly, but about how many kids are affected, say, in a given year?
Yeah, so over 2,000 young people really across the city each year that we're working with in one way or the other. We're halfway through this year now. I would say by the time we reach the end of 2017, we'll be close to 2,300, somewhere around
Goodness,
in there.
That's a lot of kids.
Yeah, but here's the number to think about, and we try to toss this out with anytime we have a Sunday school class we speak to or opportunity like this. Is there are around 12,000 children that live in what you could say are the economically disadvantaged neighborhoods in the city.
Okay,
so it's 12,000 kids. We're only working with around 2,000 of them.
You got a lot to go.
Yeah, and it does take, there's that saying, it takes a village, that whole thing, the cliche, but it genuinely does take a number of organizations and churches and groups working together in the city to reach that number of children.
Right.
And so, we're pleased and happy, and we want to be out there serving more children, but at the same time, we also applaud the work of so many other groups in the city.
Yeah.
Boys and Girls Club, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, you know, because we're all in this together.
You're on the same team.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but it's something that it's so awesome to be able to reach out and to make an impact on these kids and to at least give them the opportunity to meet Christ. You're not gonna force it down their throat.
Right.
But that's amazing. John Crooks with the Emerald Youth Foundation. We will talk more in just a second. This is Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker. Listening to Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker, author of One Dog's Faith, a book about life, trust, and worry through the eyes of a dog. If you're a worrier, or if you're a dog lover, or a mixed breed, so to speak, I think you'd like this. This is from the dog's perspective. It's my dog, Mango, watching me go through a difficult time period, and also her view of why dogs do some of the silly things they do. One Dog's Faith. It's available on Amazon, BarnesandNoble.com, Cokesbury.com, and also locally, Cedar Springs Bookstore, Long's Drugstore, Farragut Pharmacy, and many other respectable places. John Crooks is with me today from the Emerald Youth Foundation. Nice to have you.
Yeah, thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
It's really been so far enlightening on what all the Emerald Youth Foundation people are doing to help our youth in our area. And that's one of the big things. It's our area. And that's not a national program. This is something that started here.
Correct. Right.
So it's a very sweet spot for me. You said earlier you help anywhere from elementary to college mm-hmm. age kids in the disadvantaged areas. I teach Sunday school at our church, Concord Methodist, and I teach eighth and ninth graders. And it's such a sweet spot of kids kind of developing and realizing they have choices and realizing that these choices, some are good, some are bad. Yeah. And you're hopefully, I know that's a mission, is trying to catch these kids when they have opportunity and they have time after school to go down this road or go down this road. And tell me a little bit about what's fueling the Emerald Youth Foundation in this area.
Yeah, so if I had to boil it down to a sentence or two, it would be that we really envision Knoxville becoming a city where every child in every neighborhood has the opportunity for a full life. So the 12,000 young people that I mentioned before the break that are living in our city's economically depressed areas or distressed neighborhoods, the little over 2,000 young people of that 12,000 we're working with, you know, we want to, of course, see that number grow so that every one of the kids, no matter the neighborhood, no matter their, you know, background, that they have that opportunity for a full life. And we're doing that by helping them grow in their faith, their learning, and their health. And all three of those outcomes are woven into the programs that we offer city kids. Mm-hmm. And that looks like that's a couple of things. That would be our after-school / discipleship ministry with young people, and then also our sports programs.
Right. And sports is such a great way to grab somebody's heart and passion. And the after school program, it's fairly easy to visualize a fifth or sixth grader being picked up in a church van or an Emerald Youth Foundation van and saying, hey, let's go do some fun things. But an 11th grader, how does that work?
Yeah, that's a great question. So The last few years, we've really tried to hone in and focus on those older youth. Even your older middle school kids who are getting into that high school age that you're teaching in Sunday school.
Exactly. And sometimes they're just too cool for this stuff.
Right, right, right. And so a great example there is part of what we would call our discipleship ministry is we have a location, Mechanicsville, in the heart of Mechanicsville, just off of Middlebrook, kind of the Western Avenue area.
Okay.
And it's what you could say it's our college, it's our young adult college ministry.
Okay.
But we have high school students from Austin East, from Central High School, from Fulton High School, who through networking, and I use that term in terms of us getting the word out in their schools, mm-hmm. and with the folks that they're friends with and associated with, where they come to our College Street location, and we're offering ACT prep. We're providing homework
okay.
help,
okay.
Mentoring, and really those things that those high school students and even your young adults who may be right out of high school trying to pursuing college and training and that sort of thing. How can we stay connected with them and help them do that?
Well, it's so moving beyond the neighborhood.
Right,
and,
right.
And, I get that because ACT is the maker or breaker of whether they're going to go to college.
It is. And so if a young person, if a high school student, they all need, I needed it. I didn't,
yes.
I didn't do it and I should have, but that prep because the exam is, it's a tough one. And, providing that, subject specific tutoring. So for example, if a high school student's having problems with chemistry or biology or, any one of the math disciplines, we'll have volunteers, who might be, maybe it's a former math teacher who's retired.
Somebody might be darn smart.
Exactly.
In that area.
Yeah. So we're pairing those young people up, getting them the academic help that they need. Another good example is right now this summer, we've had that group. There's probably about 15 to 20 of these young people who have been going on college visits. So they've visited. They went up to Berea College up in Kentucky just a couple of weeks ago, visited the campus there. They've visited the technical schools in the area.
How about that?
And so we're trying to provide some of these experiences.
To broaden the horizon.
To broaden them and to show them this is what a college campus looks like. This is the process that you have to go through for, financial aid and admissions and all that.
So you're giving this, you can do this.
Exactly.
And these are out there. That's just really special.
Yeah.
That's really special. Talk about some of the success stories, because I know there are many. And I know that some it works on and some it doesn't. But I know that you have success stories.
We do. A couple of that come to mind couple of the young men who spoke at our prayer breakfast a couple of months ago in May, and one of them, he actually was on staff with us in the very early days. His name was Eric, and he was actually on staff with us, but so engaged with young people in the city, and he quickly built a relationship with a young man named Marcus, and Marcus was from one of our inner city neighborhoods. Had some challenges and struggles in his life, and Eric really came along and loved on him and helped him and served him.
Somebody cared, yeah.
Exactly. Eric went on to be a very successful, nonprofit leader, and so he is actually running an organization now in Lexington, Kentucky, that is similar to Emerald Youth Foundation.
Okay.
It's called the Lexington Leadership Foundation. Well. Marcus moved on and went on and graduated and got his education under his belt and everything.
Yeah.
Well, he's now working for Eric at this Leadership Foundation
awesome.
In Kentucky. And so they've kept that relationship over the years. And now it's not only a friendship, but a professional relationship. And I mean, those guys will probably, you know, be until they retire, you know.
They'll take on the world, yeah. That's but, terrific because, you know, who knows, Marcus would have not had that interaction.
Right.
And somebody who said, look, there are big things out there that God has enabled you to do. You may not think so because you're in an economically depressed area.
Right.
And they may not have used those words.
Right.
But you know, just to say, look, you're something.
Yeah.
And he believed it.
Exactly. Yeah. And you know, from an Emerald Youth standpoint, we were able to come along beside a young man like Marcus, provide him with some of those resources and things that he didn't even maybe realize he needed.
Yep.
At that age. And then, you know, here we are all these years later, and he's, you know, successfully, you know, giving back in a,
yeah,
in a, you know, a similar way. You know, and there are many stories. There's a young lady who comes to my mind in her late 20s now, working at a law firm here in town, you know, started with us when she was in middle school.
Wow.
And, you know, went through a lot of, you know,
yeah,
struggles and challenges, but persevered, graduated from Fulton High School, went on and earned her bachelor's degree, and is, you know, now in a professional track. And it's, there's, you know, many, many stories,
sure,
like that.
Sure. And I think what you're marketing, what you're selling is hope. And I don't care if you're in an economically depressed area or not. If hope disappears or looks too far to be able to reach, we as humans just start grabbing onto whatever's close by. But
right,
but you're offering these kids hope.
Yeah, and again, for us, it's rooted in the hope of Christ, you know.
Yes.
And so we,
I was hoping this way. so we
don't want to lose sight of that. You know, even with all of the sports and the different things that we offer, it's, you know, it's all rooted in,
it's embedded in there.
It is, yeah.
That's magic. That's so awesome. John Crooks with the Emerald Youth Foundation here in Knoxville. You're the marketing PR communications director. And we have more to talk about with John, because this is not only something that he's doing, but it's something that they offer opportunities for us to be some kind of part of that in order to help some of these, a lot of these kids. This is Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker, author of One Dog's Faith, and we'll deal with more in just a minute.
Just hold on to the promises. Hold on to the promises. Jesus is alive, so hold tight. Hold on to the promises. What will I say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone.
You're listening to Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker. Really glad to have you along. John Crooks is in the studio, and we've been talking about Emerald Youth Foundation. John is the marketing and communications director, and we've learned a lot about the process, and we've learned a lot about who you're helping and how it's happening. But what I want to hear, what's fueling you to do this, and why when you get there you go, oh yeah. I'm ready.
Most days, right?
yeah. No, it doesn't happen every day, but I know that it's, you know, you're helping,
right? Yeah. I think you know, so for me personally, having been with Emerald for 10 and a half years now, we were talking before the show started, so I have a media background, specifically radio, and love broadcast media, still do have a heart for it. Like, the bug never leaves
it,
you, right?
It never goes away.
And so it's always been a part of who I am and, you know, what I enjoy doing. Shortly after my first children were born, and I say children because we had two daughters at once. My wife and I had twins.
Oh, you just wanted to double the family. Yeah, we're just like
get right to it.
Yeah.
So in a short period of time, we had twin girls, and then another little girl came along. And so within a very brief time, we had three little girls, you know, in the house. And
That changes your perspective a little bit.
It does. And it changes scheduling and priorities and all of that. Yeah. And for me personally, just kind of reached a point of, you know, is the daily grind of media work, you know, something that that I want to continue to do long term, and so decided to step out of that from a 24/7 perspective.
Sure.
Look to pursue some other things, and through some relationships, landed at Emerald Youth Foundation, and that was in, I guess, 2006. And Steve Diggs and our team there were looking to expand some of the work they did in terms of fundraising and marketing and
awareness.
Communications awareness. Sure. Yeah, exactly. And so joined the team here at Emerald, and have been there ever since. And
it sounds to me more like God said, "Listen, I'm going to take what you have learned and the talents I've given you, and I'm going to put you in a place where it can make a difference."
That's very well said. Yes.
Yeah. I'll say it from an outsider's point of view.
You know, because quite honestly, if you had asked me all those years ago in college when I was going through, you know, yes, UT's broadcasting program, it's like the term nonprofit never crossed my mind.
Exactly.
Right?
I'm going to be a star.
Never thought of nonprofit work,
yeah, but look at what he's done.
God, you know, God led me there, and it's been a tremendous opportunity. And so I think, you know, what your question, what gets me up and gets me going each day, I'd say you think about the success stories like I shared before the break, and there are those, but, you know, in looking at the work that remains, you know, each day.
Sure.
And so when I'm out, at some of the churches or the Sansom Sports Complex, wherever it may be, where we have kids involved in our programs, and I'm, taking pictures for social media, whatever it is, from a communication standpoint, you see the kids, you see, their families, you see my colleagues who are working with them one-on-one, and some of the challenges and things that they're all facing. And, it makes the hard work, worth the effort.
Yeah, and one thing I can imagine that may be going on through your head, we're helping this group right here, but goodness, how many more are out there?
Right, yeah.
And you're, I know you're when we talked about this, you're planting seeds of hope, and man, there's a lot of obstacles for a child in a depressed area to actually see hope.
Right, and from the awareness standpoint, hopefully the better that I get at my job, each and every day, the more that we're able to put the word out about what we're doing, in the heart of Knoxville. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hopefully the more, resources that we have available to the ministry, as more people learn about us and we mm-hmm. share our message, then impacts the number of kids and families we're able to serve.
We will definitely talk here in a minute about how people listening can help and be involved with what you do. I also want to talk about your growing opportunities, because you're reaching, you said, 2,300 kids
right.
a year, and that's just scratching the surface of the 12 or plus thousand kids that are in search of or needing help.
Right.
What's going on? How can you grow? If you had the resources and you had the buy-in of our city leaders, and I know that they support you, they definitely do, but where can you go from here?
Yeah, it's been amazing to see. So a quick step back, when I first started at Emerald, we had really two or three locations that we were in ministry with full time. One of the first kind of PR things that I did was one of the churches that came along in our discipleship ministry that signed on as a partner church with us. That was one of the first projects that I had, and it was neat to be able to share that and, help put that out there. And then here we are all these years later with the number of churches that have grown and the number of kids being served. And there's a large tract of property in the heart of Lonsdale. There's some property that's owned by the city of Knoxville and then also by Knox County. And we are working right now with those entities to take that property and turn it into a multi-purpose facility, a community center, and a sports complex for families right there in Lonsdale.
Right there in the heart of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And folks over the years, literally going back a decade now, have been residents in Lonsdale and in the community have been asking for something like this. And, you know, everything at this point seems to be lining up, but there are still some hoops to jump through. And
no ground's broken just yet.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And so we, you know, we're just continuing to get community input and ask folks, you know, for listeners to your program, Tom, who might live in Lonsdale or even outside of Lonsdale who are interested in learning more about this project, they can go to our website at emeraldyouth.org, find out all the details about it. But it'll be a great facility where all the things that we've talked about from an academic, you know, learning standpoint with young people, from a fitness standpoint, all of those things would be present there, and to serve children and young people and their parents and grandparents right there in the Lonsdale.
Yeah, it could have a big impact.
Yeah.
And a place for the kids to go and see Christ in action.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
It's really big. And you have we'll talk about how people can help, but one thing I want to talk about before we break is events you have coming up.
Yeah, yeah. So our golf tournament is really, I guess it's our second longest running fundraiser that we have. It'll be coming up on September 25th at Holston Hills Country Club.
Okay.
And Coach Rick Barnes, the Tennessee men's basketball team. He is the namesake of the tournament. So it's Rick Barnes Emerald Youth Golf Classic, and Coach Barnes is on our board of directors.
Okay,
and he's
obviously a big believer in what you do.
He is, and from a faith standpoint, he is just a godly, wonderful man, and he really cares about our city. He cares about children and young people and their growth and maturity, and so. So he's been part of this tournament for a little while now, and we're, you know, folks, anyone interested in playing or sponsoring the tournament, we'd love to have them.
Yeah, because that really is a big source of income. Not income, but funding.
Exactly.
For you guys.
Yeah.
All right, and in just a minute, we'll talk other ways where people can either volunteer and find their little home in being able to help you, or monetarily, either one. It's John Crooks with the Emerald Youth Foundation, such a powerful force for disadvantaged kids right here in our area, and they're really helping a lot. We'll talk more in just a minute. This is Dealing with Life.
I will hold you when you're breaking, like a father and a friend. And I will carry you through darkness till we see the sun again. So rest your head and cry your tears. Know that I am with you here when you can't lift that weight. Believe me when I say I will.
This is Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker, and really hope you've enjoyed today's program. We've had John Crooks with the Emerald Youth Foundation talking about what they do, and what I want to get into here in a second, John, is how people can help. But for those who missed it up front, give us a quick overview of what it is.
So at Emerald Youth Foundation, again, we envision Knoxville becoming a city where every child in every neighborhood has the opportunity for a full life. And our aim and our ambition to do that is we want to help end the isolation and disconnection of young people in our city. We want to be drawing them into healthy, supportive community. And then in doing all that, we want to raise up this next generation of leaders. And we're starting with young kids and, you know, going all the way through high school, college age.
Yeah.
And just excited about the ongoing work.
And I think that's that just, to me, opened up a whole new vision of what you are when you go all the way through college age.
Yeah.
And remind kids you can be something.
Right.
That's big. So the all-important question for sure. our listeners is how can we help?
Yeah. The easiest way, folks can reach us through our website, which is emeraldyouth.org. And on there, on our there's a tab that says Get Involved, Contact Us. They can check those out, learn about all the opportunities. Folks can actually submit a volunteer application on there.
Okay.
There are job opportunities on there. Whether we have a number of part-time paid positions that are available going into the fall, into the new school year.
Like what? What would volunteer opportunities be?
Yeah, so from a volunteer standpoint, that's anything from providing homework help and tutoring for young people to helping, you know, prepare and serve meals on a Wednesday night.
Okay.
That might be helping to coach or be an assistant coach for one of our sports. I didn't go into too many details about our sports, but we're talking about volleyball, basketball, soccer, our swim team, our Learn to Swim
you have
program.
A swim team.
We
That's
do have
awesome.
A competitive summer swim team. These kids are actually, I think they have a meet this week or next week. So
okay.
they're, yeah. So it's a very broad range of volunteer opportunities. Or if you're somebody who's just interested in coming in and helping, you know, seal envelopes and put, you know, stamps on thank you notes for us. We,
yeah,
we're
you,
all
you
over
need
it.
People
we
to do that.
Yeah.
Because it just takes time.
Exactly, it does.
And then also the other end of helping you is donations.
Yeah, exactly.
How would somebody do that?
So, again, very easy to give online. You can give via your credit or debit card. Go to emeraldyouth.org. Folks can also mail in checks to Emerald Youth Foundation. And then, you know, we mentioned earlier we have our golf tournament and a couple other fundraisers each year where folks can, you know, sponsor and donate that way. You know, from a one-time gift to monthly giving opportunities, we're open to any of that.
Yeah, because that's how you operate.
Yeah,
that's what's funding the program mm-hmm. is dollars from, and it stays right here in the community.
It does. Yeah, that's a great point to stress. It's all right here in the city of Knoxville.
And kids that are talented, that are driven just by a little push.
Yeah,
and goodness, most importantly, they're opened, their eyes are open to Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
man, and that's so powerful because churches are on every corner, but kids don't always feel welcome or not always given the opportunity to go.
Mm-hmm.
And you have.
Yeah, well, We're 25 years into this and don't plan on slowing down anytime soon. And so we're grateful for the opportunity to continue to spread the word about it.
John Crooks with the Emerald Youth Foundation. What my eyes are wide open to what you do now. Just I'm taken. That's so powerful.
Well, thank you.
Thank you for being here and sharing.
You're welcome.
And I pray that there are people listening who are driven and motivated to help you.
Well, thank you. Appreciate the time.
This is Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker. And if you find yourself in struggle or in a difficult position, or if you know somebody who is, remember God is right there. Remember there is hope. Through God, there's hope in any situation, and there is power at your fingertips. When you talk to God, when you pray, realize you're praying to the most powerful thing there is in the universe. Now, God may not choose to remove you from the situation, but He will always give you the strength to pull through it. Remember, you are not alone. There are plenty of people ready to help you, and there are plenty of people that are struggling just like you. But just ask yourself, what can I learn through this situation? What can I do by learning through this situation to help others? God will always take a situation and turn it into a blessing if we allow it. Embrace the journey that this life is. It's a beautiful journey, and through God, it can always be joyful. This is Dealing with Life. I'm Tom Baker, and may God shower you with blessings. It's been-